Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
A very warm welcome to our end of term family service. Dear friends in Christ, today we draw near to the end of our journey through Lent. During the past 40 days, we have been encouraged to re-examine our lives and, through disciplined prayer, Bible study, and self-denial, to renew our discipleship of Christ. We have endeavoured to follow his way, the path of sacrifice and service, and to prepare ourselves for the celebration of his resurrection. We are gathered here to remember the day when Jesus entered his own city one last time to challenge its leaders with the message of God's unconditional love. We know that the message was rejected and its bearer handed over to torture and death. Let us, in union with our fellow pilgrims throughout the world, follow him now, moved by his sufferings and obedient to his call. God our Father, whose Son Jesus Christ entered Jerusalem to the cheers of palm-waving crowds, let these palm crosses be a witness to his sacrifice and a token of our faith in him, who gave his life for the world's salvation and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever.
Amen.
O Lord, open our lips. Let us worship the Lord. We turn to our hymn books for our opening hymn number 217, All Glory and God and Honour to Thee, Redeemer King. And in this hymn, we omit verse number 2. On Sunday, the crowds hailed Jesus as King. On Good Friday, they shouted for him to die. Confessing that our faith is often shallow, we ask forgiveness for our sins. Lord Jesus, we come to you with a kind heart to make peace with us. Lord, have mercy. We come to us in humility. Would we like to be the center of attention? Christ, have mercy. You come to us offering forgiveness. Would we blame on us for our failures? Lord, have mercy. You come to us as a servant. We prefer to serve our own purposes. Lord, forgive us and help us. May Almighty God, who sent His Son into the world to save sinners, bring you His pardon and His peace, now and forever.
Amen.
Your word is a lamp unto my feet.
Amen.
O Lord, your word is everlasting. Let us then receive the word of the Lord. Our reading today will be read by Caleb. Sing the hymn number 223, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Thank you. king coming in a triumphal procession into Jerusalem. Crowds gathering around him, cutting down palm branches and waving them, shouting Hosanna, taking their cloaks and throwing them on the road in front of him. You would probably think that I was telling you the story of Palm Sunday, the story which Caitlin has just read for us. And I might well be. But I could be telling you a completely different story, and you might realize it. I could be telling you a story about a man called Judas Maccabeus. Judas Maccabeus was a leader of the Jews about, give or take, about 200 years before Jesus. And at that time, the Jewish nation was occupied not by the Romans, but by the Syrians. And they were having a fairly miserable time of it. And Judas Maccabeus was a priest by profession. He was the son of one of the temple priests, and he himself was a priest. But he was also one of the great leaders of the Jewish people. And he managed to organize a revolt against the Syrians who were occupying the Holy Land. And he led the Jewish forces to a great military victory. And they managed to overthrow the occupying Syrians and re-establish the Jewish kingdom. And the first thing that Judas Maccabeus did when he got there was to restore the temple in Jerusalem, to restore the worship of God in the holy city. And there was a huge triumphal procession into the temple, and he led the procession on his donkey. The crowd shouted, Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. They cut down the palm branches, they took their cloaks and spread them on the road, and off he went into the temple in Jerusalem. And it was all about, I think it was 163 BC, so almost 200 years, 190 something years before Jesus' death. And it was an extraordinary, wonderful event for the Jews. And in fact, it was so important to them that they still celebrate today. They instituted a festival, and the festival is called Hanukkah. And to this very day, Jews across the world still celebrate Hanukkah. They celebrate that liberation from bondage, that restoration of their faith and their worship in Jerusalem, and they remember Judas Maccabeus and his followers. And so, for the crowds who gathered in Jerusalem on the first Palm Sunday, they would have known these stories. These stories were important to them. This was part of their history, their heritage. This was who they were, and that they wanted to celebrate. They could see another Savior coming who was going to do exactly the same as Judas Maccabeus. He was going to take the Roman army and drive them out. He was going to re-establish the Jewish kingdom, and life was going to be great again for the children of Israel. And so they reenacted what they saw, or what they celebrated every year. They remembered the stories of Hanukkah, and they recreated them on that first Palm Sunday. They saw someone coming to lead them to freedom, so they cried, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest. They were there to welcome a Savior. The only problem was, it wasn't the sort of Savior they wanted. They didn't realize what sort of Savior this was that was coming. All they could see was a Savior who would drive out the Romans. But Jesus was a very different sort of Savior. He had come not to save them from politics, not to save them from other armies, but from sin and death and eternal damnation. So Palm Sunday begins as a great day of joy and excitement, a day of celebration, a wonderful moment as the Savior arrives. But it all changes too quickly. Within a couple of days, that king will stand there in the heart of Jerusalem, and the crowds will stand before him. But this time, there'll be no shouts of Hosanna. The shouts will be, crucify him, crucify him. There'll be no soft palm branches cut from the trees to hail his arrival, but only the hard and unyielding wood of the cross. There'll be no cloaks spread before him on the road, but he'll be dressed in a purple robe, mocked and ridiculed, before the soldiers take that robe and dangle for it. There'll be no royal diadem of gold and jewels, but only a crown of thorns placed on his forehead. The Savior who they welcome has become the one who they mock and scorn and ridicule. And it's easy for us to say, well, weren't they foolish? Could they not see what was going on that day? Why could they not understand? What sort of mistake did those people make? But we are guilty of doing the self-same thing. Each and every one of us, throughout our lives, does the same thing. We stand in church on Sunday morning and sing our hosannas and worship Jesus with all our heart and soul. We believe in him. We want to trust him and follow him and love him and serve him. But then we go out into the world, and on Monday it's a bit harder. On Tuesday it's harder again. On Wednesday and Thursday it's harder and harder. In the school playground, in work, in our homes, in our leisure, in our hobbies. Do we continue to worship Jesus in all we say and do? Or do we forget? When we're dealing with others, do we ask ourselves that question? What would Jesus do? How would Jesus speak? What are the things that Jesus would think were important? When we see someone doing something wrong, do we just say, just go with the flow? Or do we challenge it? Does our faith make us different in the way we act in the world, we live in the world? Or is it just too easy to go with the flow and forget about it? So often, we do forget about Jesus. We go with the flow. We allow things to pass by unchallenged. And we become just like those crowds. And we don't even realize it ourselves. We call Jesus Lord and Saviour and Master in church, but we forget about it in the school playground. Or maybe, like those crowds, the part of the problem is that we're looking for a Saviour, but the wrong sort of Saviour. We're looking for someone who will make us feel good about ourselves, who will make us feel happy, who will affirm us, who will tell us that we're always right, and everyone else is wrong. But that's not the sort of person Jesus is. Jesus looks at us and shows us what is wrong in our lives and in our hearts. And then he tells us what to do about it. And none of us like being told we're wrong. Over the next 7 days, we're going on a journey, an extraordinary, immense journey. And in that journey, we find out what it is to call Jesus Saviour. What it means to say Jesus loves me. What is the depth and the length and the height of Jesus' love? What it means to sing Hosanna and to take our cloaks and lay them before him. And I want to invite you again to be part of that journey every single night this week. This is the most important week of the year and the most important journey that we can make. A journey that takes us from Palm Sunday to the upper room, to the cross, to the tomb, to the glory, to the shame, and ultimately to the resurrection. But this journey doesn't just begin today. It's a journey that began right back at the beginning of creation. It began with a snake and an apple. The journey began with our sin, our pride, our rebellion against God. The journey began when we thought we knew better than God, when we thought we could tell God what to do, when we allowed sin into our world, into our lives, into our very hearts. And once that happened, we were lost because we could not enter into the presence of a holy God. We couldn't earn forgiveness or deal with that sin on our own. So God sent the law. He gave Moses the law, carved in tablets of stone in Mount Sinai. And that was a stepping stone to bring us back to God, to show us what was wrong and what we needed to do about it. But it soon became clear that we couldn't do anything about it. We couldn't keep that law. Sin was still a burden preventing us. The children of Israel tried, but it didn't work. And so the result was death. That was the price, the penalty that awaited each and every one of us. We needed a Saviour, someone who could break that hold which death and sin had over us, who could go through the valley of death's shadow and come out to the other side, having broken the power of death and opening for us a way into the kingdom of heaven. And that is the story of the cross. That's the power of the cross. And that's what we celebrate this week, as we journey into the passion of our Lord and Saviour. When you came into church, you were given a palm cross. And I want to invite every one of you to take this cross home and to think about where you're going to put it. You might want to put it beside your bed so you can see it every morning and every evening. You might want to put it beside the front door so you can see it every time you come in and every time you go out. Or if you're like me, possibly the best place to put it is beside the kettle. So you see it every time you make a cup of coffee. That's probably the place I go most often in the house. But think about where you can see it regularly. Because this palm cross is such an important symbol for us. It's a reminder to us, as every cross is, of the sacrifice Jesus made. It's a reminder of the price he paid. But it's more than that, because it's not just another cross. It's a cross made out of palm branches. And so it's a reminder of the palm branches that were laid before Jesus' feet on the first Palm Sunday, and how quickly that changed. How the crowd changed and turned on him. How they went from crying Hosanna to crucify. And it's a reminder that we shouldn't allow ourselves to fall into that same trap. Because it's all too easy to stand here in church, to sing our hymns, to worship God, and then to go out and forget about him. So the palm cross reminds us of those who forgot. Those who were there with enthusiasm. Those who were there with excitement. Those who were there with love. But he turned on Jesus. And not just after years, but within a matter of days, who turned and went to shout, "Crucify." Every time we look at the palm cross, it should remind us that we shouldn't be the people who come to worship on a Sunday, but forget about Jesus on a Monday. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We turn to our order of service now for the next hymn. Oh, to see the dawn of the darkest day, Christ on the road to Calvary. This, the power of the cross.
Christ on the road, Calvary.
Our prayers this morning will be led by Reuben and Evan.
We pray that the Lord Jesus, who entered Jerusalem on Palm Sunday to cleanse and save God's people, will today find us ready to follow him. As you gave us an example of humble service, so guide our Queen and all leaders to serve their people with devotion and bring peace between the nations, Lord, in your mercy. As you sacrificed your life for the world's salvation, so give strength and patience to those who make great sacrifices in the car of ours, Lord, in your mercy. As you cleanse the temple, so cleanse your church today of disunity, hypocrisy, and complacency, Lord, in your mercy.
You taught the people the truth about God. Teach us your ways, rely your love, and send us out with your spirit. So, serve others, Lord, in your mercy. Be close to who suffer. Grant healing, strength, encouragement, Lord, in your mercy. Remember those who have died. Grant us them and share the entire kingdom, Lord, in your mercy. Savior of the world,
yeah. Blessed are you, Holy God, Creator, Redeemer, and Life-Giver. You have spoken the word into being and filled it with wonder and beauty. For every blessing you have received. Blessed are you, Holy God, for people of every language and culture, and for the rich variety you give to life. For every blessing you have received. Blessed are you, Holy God, for Jesus Christ our Savior, truly divine and truly human, living and dying for us and going before us in heaven. For every blessing you have received. Blessed are you, Holy God, for your Spirit, the fire of love, burning in our hearts, bringing us to faith and calling us to holiness in the church and in the world. For every blessing you have received. Almighty and everlasting God, who in your tender love towards the human race sent your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, to take upon him our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross, grant that we may follow the example of his patience and humility, and also be made partakers of his resurrection through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Christ, give you grace to grow in holiness, to deny yourselves, to take up your cross and to follow him. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. The only announcement this morning is about the services which are taking place all week. I've been mentioning over the past few weeks these flyers that are in the porch. And if there are family members, neighbours, relatives, people that are finding it hard to come back to church after the pandemic, you feel free to take one of these and give it to them as an invitation to come along this week. It's a chance to come back to God, back to worship, and back to the foot of the cross. Tomorrow night, we're here at 7:30 when we'll have Reverend Mark Dodds as our preacher from the Presbyterian Church. On Tuesday, we'll be in Dunmore. On Wednesday, back here. And the focus on Wednesday is going to be on young people. But as I said, every night is for the whole family. It's not an excuse for the older folk to stay home on Wednesday. And younger folk are welcome every night. Thursday, we're back in St. Patrick's again, and we'll be celebrating in the upper room, remembering that night when Jesus gathered his disciples together. On Friday, here at the foot of the cross, when we bring all our concerns, our worries, our anxieties, and our burdens, and lay them before Jesus' cross. And then on Saturday, we think about the promises that were made in our baptism, the vows made by our parents and our godparents, and then renewed by ourselves in confirmation. And we commit ourselves to keeping those again in the year ahead. And then next Sunday, 11:30, we're back for family communion and holy baptism. So I'd encourage you to go out and ask somebody to come along every night. If every one of you brought one person every night, and then the next night, that one person brought somebody else, we'll soon have the church packed all week. Our final hymn, number 224, How Deep the Father's Love for Us, How Vast Beyond All Measure.
Thank you.
pray together, be with us, Lord. As we go out into the world, may the lips that have sung your praise always speak the truth. May the ears which have heard your word listen only to what is true. And may our lives, as well as our worship, be always pleasing in your sight, for the glory of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.